Hi, APC family. Happy Sunday. I'm so excited that you joined us this morning. We're about to get into worship, and I hope that our service impacts you today and that you feel the presence of God. Don't forget to like and share this with a few friends and family members you know would enjoy today's service. Well, let's get into it.
His word declares, I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praises shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord, and the humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. Come on, let's lift him up in this place today. We're already on your mind. Can't explain your love with a performance. You call us your own, but in our foreign. With your blood, you bought our freedom. Can't explain your love, yeah. Ruler of everything, yeah. Worthy of all that we could. You are great, Jehovah, all power.
Somebody shout hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus. There's only one name with power to save. Thank you, Lord. Come on, Zion. Let's declare it together.
There is only one.
Under heaven by which men can be saved, healed, delivered, set free. It's the name of Jesus, and it has power to save. Oh Lord, now let's sing it together. Oh Lord, He is champion. Eternally, from everlasting to everlasting, He is God. Woo! Yes, He is. So come on, Zion, let's declare it.
Every knee.
Yeah. a kingdom that cannot be moved. Of his pavilion. Oh God, he hides us in a secret place. And so we say we look to him today. We will not be overwhelmed. We will not be shaken. But we will look to Jehovah, our God, who is the conquering lion. Hallelujah. God, I look to you. I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like you do. God, I look to you. You're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom. You know just what to do. He knows just what to do. Oh God, he is omnipotent, omnipresent. Come on, let's sing it together. God, I look to you. Come on, look to him this morning. No matter what's going on around us, we're going to be firmly planted on the rock today. Oh God, I look to you. He is where my help. Give us wisdom.
Give me wisdom.
You know just what to do.
Just what to do.
Hallelujah. He knows just what to do. Even in moments of doubt and fear, we can trust in him, our rock and our strength. Now come on, let's lift it up together. Sing.
I will love you, Lord, my strength.
Hallelujah.
I will love you, Lord, my shield.
Yeah. Hey. Hallelujah. Yes, come on, sing it out, Zion. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yeah. Come on, y'all. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Staying there for just a moment. Come on, we're joining with creation this morning in acknowledgement of our Savior, He who reigns upon the throne. For the Lord. Come on, we need to declare that. I don't know what it is, but I feel like staying right here one more time. Shatalabaha. Father, hear your people sing for the Lord. It's not Buddha, it's not Muhammad, but we sing hallelujah. Yes, He reigns. One more time, take it out. Hallelujah.
Yeah. bless the name of Jesus. He is worthy. He is worthy of all praise and all glory. He is the King of Kings this day. He is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords over your life. Father, we desire to be with you, Lord God. We thank you that you come right now in the midst and you inhabit the praises of your people, Lord. Oh, Father, we just stir it up afresh, Lord God. We stir it up afresh on the inside of us, Lord God. We stir up your Spirit, Lord God. We stir up, Lord God, the Spirit. We stir up the gifts, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. Father, we release. We release corporately right now an anointing in this place, Lord God, to break bondages right now, to see people delivered, Lord God. Father, in the name of Jesus, to break the back of the enemy, we declare a breakthrough into the atmosphere right now, in the name of Jesus, because God is holy and God is mighty and he is king and he is greater than the circumstance. He is greater. Can I get an amen? Hallelujah. He is greater. Father, we declare that into our lives right now. You are the greater. You are the greater. We desire, Lord God, a divine exchange, Lord God. Father, more of you, Jesus. More of you, Jesus. Oh, take control, Lord God. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Oh, we worship a God who is living. We worship a God who is not dead, but is close. He is close to you. His air is so close to you. Oh, God, come into the midst, Lord. You're in the midst, Lord. Father, stir us afresh, Lord. Stir us afresh in this place, Lord God. A fresh fire, Lord God. A fresh fire, Lord God. Oh, for what's ahead, a fresh fire and a fresh wind of the Holy Spirit. We say go, we say release in the name of Jesus. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We bless your name as we're seated in his presence and we continue to worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Oh, bless you, bless you. The Lord desires from us a divine exchange, relationship and a divine exchange in the Spirit. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. I just want to bring your attention to a scripture today that God just laid on my heart, and it has to do with relationship and an exchange. You know, I live my life on two things that I know, that God is good and he is not withholding anything to them that live uprightly. So that means when sickness comes, God is still good, right? When sorrow comes, God is still good. When fear comes, God is still good. But more than that, he tells us to exchange that. Exchange our weakness, exchange our sorrow, exchange our lack for everything that he has to provide. So John chapter 2 says, on the third day, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Now both Jesus and his disciples were invited to the wedding. And when they ran out of wine, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." And Jesus said to her, "Woman, what does your concern have to do with me? My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Whatever he says to do, whatever he says to you, do it." Now there were set there 6 water pots of stone, according to the manner of purification of the Jews, containing 20 or 30 gallons apiece. And Jesus said to them, "Fill the water pots with water." And they filled them up to the brim. And he said to them, "Draw some out now and take it to the master of the feast." And they took it. I want to draw your attention to 2 things in this scripture. One of them is that Mary says to Jesus, hey, Jesus, there's no wine. And Jesus said, what is that concerning me? What is that concerning me? Now is not my season. And then she says to them, whatever he says to you, do it. There's a relationship here that's happening. And this is a relationship God desires with us. Mary knows Jesus. She has relationship with him. Sometimes I wonder why God put that scripture in there. That Jesus says, it's not my time. But yet because of relationship, Mary moved on him and plans changed. Jesus was willing to change plans because divine appointment happened, divine intimacy and exchange in relationship called and moved God's hand. How about you know that when you have God's heart and God has your heart, you have his hand. He was moved, his hand moved because Mary said, no, I have relationship with him. I know who he is. And this day, God is desiring you to exchange what you don't have for what he has. If you have fear, he's willing to come in and he's going to bring his love. He says, if you have mourning, he's going to give you dancing. He is the great divine God. And he desires to come into our little space and have relationship with us. And not just that, to give us gifts, to help us, to make us great and tell us greater works that you're going to do than what I have done. Who is this God? I want to talk today about a God who desires, and there's a sacrifice that's required on our end, but it's so small compared to what God gives in return. I want to tell you today, if you're lacking in your finances, God is able to exchange something with you. He's able to exchange something with you. You give unto God and he gives over exceedingly above, increase and multiplication. That is the God that we serve. I want to leave with you the words to a song. And this song is about a divine exchange. And in it, it says, God says, what's that you have in your hand? I can use it if you're willing to lose it. Take the little you have and make it grand, because I am El Shaddai and I'll more than supply your need. I will more than supply your need. He is El Shaddai. He is Jehovah Shammah. He is with you. He is close to you. Father, we pray right now, Lord God, for that divine exchange as we bring, Lord God, our gifts, as we bring, Lord God, our tithe, as we bring, Lord God, our offering to you, Lord God. Father, we submit them to you, and we, Father, call on our relationship for the divine exchange, Lord God. Father, you take what's small and you make it great and you make it grand, Father, that you would supply every need, that there would be no lack in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you that you are the God of exceedingly, abundantly, above all we could ask or think. We declare that over your body today, Lord, in Jesus' name. No lack, multiplication, and increase. Thank you, Lord. We bless the name of the Lord. And there's a few ways that we can give, and we have a video, and we just want you to take a look at that, and you can find out how.
Here at APC, giving is easier than ever. Here are four ways you can give today. Try our new preferred method, e-transfer. Just open your personal banking app and send to donations@allpeopleschurch.ca. It's that quick and easy. Please make sure to include all information for tax return purposes. Give in person through debit, credit, or cash. For building hours, please visit our website. You can also mail your checks to All People's Church, 41 Finchgate Boulevard. You can give securely online by visiting our website. Donate once or set up a reoccurring gift. For more information on how to give, please visit allpeopleschurch.ca/giving. Thank you so much for your generosity. Your donations are supporting the growth of our community, and it's your donations that are truly making a difference.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, thank you, thank you. We welcome you officially here today. We're so glad that you are in the house with us. We just bless you. We just love you. And, you know, we believe that God is going to do great things in this house today as Pastor Tony brings the word. But before Pastor Tony comes to bring the word, I just want to make you aware of a few things. If you would like to receive your tax receipt and your address is not updated, could you please see the resource center and make sure that your address is updated. If you're watching online, you can email info@allpeopleschurch.ca and you can give them your updated information, just because we want to make sure that those get to you this year. So remember that. Also, we have for the month of January, for those of you that might know and might not know, we'll be praying for every family after the service in person for the week, for the whole month of January, for the weeks of the 23rd and the 30th. For those of you that cannot make it in person and would like to do a Zoom, we will set that up for you. You can register on apc.life and we will set up a Zoom call for you, and you will be able to pray for you through that means. So you can do two things. You can be in person here and Pastor will pray for you, or you can sign up online and he will pray for you after the service. So be blessed with that. We are coming up very soon, starting on the 17th, to our week of prayer. For that whole week, we will be praying and fasting, and you may have been given something, a slip of paper when you came in, that just identifies when you will be able to pray and fast with us. So if you can fill that out and drop it into the basket at guest services when you leave, then that will be very good. And we want to join together and start the year the way that we always should be throughout the year. We start it right, we're going to end it right in prayer, right? Amen. So you fill that out and join us together for that week of prayer, and we're going to see God do amazing things as he brings a word for us for this new season. And so we want to welcome Pastor Tony right now to bring the word. I pray that you would open your hearts, yes, to receive what he has to say, and let God just begin to move and deliver and save and reveal to you in Jesus' name.
Well, good morning, church. I trust that you are doing well. It's so good to see you. Liam, I need to hear you, my brother. I need to hear some volume there. And we bless God for this brother and for the wonderful worship team. Can we give a great big hand to the worship team? I trust that even those of you that are joining us online are sensing the power, the presence of the Lord. You know, I've shared with you many times that I love music. God created music. God created sound, and I enjoy various genres. But you know, there's just something happens, something that is life-giving when we sing about the Lord, when we sing to the Lord, when we just magnify Him. Truly, atmosphere shift. It's not a gimmick. It's not a marketing term we use. Literally, the presence of God is invited into your area, into your space. I can't even explain it other than to tell you it is something supernatural that happens. I would encourage you, you know, in your car, if you're on the GO train, wherever you are, you know, fill your heart, fill your mind with music that is anointed. Now, let me be clear. I'm not saying that all Christian music is anointed. I'm talking about songs that are birthed in the Spirit of God that are absolutely life-giving. I really believe I have an assignment today, and thank you for those of you that are joining us online. I know that some have to join us because you're not feeling well. Your body isn't where it should be, and we love you. We miss you. We declare the healing of the living God in and over your lives. And I thank you for the people that are here. Those of you that are watching, remember to just, you know, like us, you know, like, you know, that little, the thumb, give us the Fonzie thumb there that they give us on YouTube. Some of you are like, who's Fonzie? Yeah, you'll find out later on. Anyway, but give us a like there. We do appreciate you joining us. I know there's people in the Caribbean, different places, but you know, I've been really wanting to move on to our new sermon series upon this rock. And And I thought I kind of had started last week, and I really felt that the Lord arrested me this week. And the Lord was saying to me, you know, I don't want you to leave New Year's Eve quite so quickly. There's things that I want you to continue to draw on from that message. And so that's what I'm going to do this morning. I want to be obedient to God, and I want to draw again. I want to go back to New Year's Eve. I want to go back to this man, Caleb, because, you know, the truth is, my friends, that everybody that I've spoken to, spiritual people, leaders, all of them, I keep hearing this thread that we are going to need something different, something that is unique from God, from an anointing perspective in 2022 that we have not had in other years, because there is a different climate in the spirit realm. There is a different climate that we are living in, and particularly in the nation of Canada. You know, I've been praying about this, thinking about this. I hear from different people that live in parts of the region of the country, and it's almost like there's like a cloud over this nation. It's almost like there's a darkness that wants to envelop the nation. Almost like people are depressed, people are discouraged, and I recognize that there's some normality to that, because, you know, after the holidays and the festivities, there's kind of this down time and people kind of feel a little bit gloomy. But I'm not talking about the normal warfare. I'm not talking about the normal things that are happening even in our mental health, but I'm talking about something spiritually, because I think you don't have to be a spiritual giant to figure out that the powers that be are passing laws and making decisions, intentionally, by the way, that are moving away from a Judeo-Christian value. They're moving our values, they're moving our nation. They indicate that they are speaking, you know, for all Canadians, when in reality, if you actually do the math and you look at elections, they're, you know, when you have a minority government, you're probably speaking for a quarter of Canadians, if that even makes sense. But they make these bold statements, they're making these bold statements about our nation. And you know, when you tell God to get lost so many times, what the Lord does is he kind of backs off a little bit, and he says, well, let me see what you can do. Let me see what, you know, what you think you can make happen in your own ability. And my friends, let's be honest, in our own ability, it's a disaster. It's a disaster. We need God. We need God in our nation. We need the wisdom of God, the power of God, the blessing of God. And we know that even the forefathers of our nation have laid the foundation in biblical value right there in concrete. On the parliament buildings, it says that he shall have dominion from sea to sea. I mean, the people that, listen, if you work there, don't you see that every day? Right there, God speaking to you right through the concrete. That the nation belongs to Canada. And so you and I, my friends, listen, you and I as the church have a responsibility. And I believe with all my heart, that the church is stronger, more powerful, has more force, has more ability than we give ourselves credit for. I believe the enemy sometimes has a better understanding of who we are than we have of ourselves. And that's why he continuously tries to convince us that we're nothing, that we're weak, you know, that we're impotent, that we have no ability, that, you know, as we look at the life of Joshua and Caleb there, where the spies, or 10 of the spies, they saw themselves as grasshoppers. The enemy wants to convince us you're nothing, you're grasshoppers, you're bugs, and I can step out on you at any time. But the reality is that in 2,000 years, God continues to use the church, and God continues to use the church in mighty ways. And my friends, you and I, we're equipped. You say, well, Pastor, I don't feel equipped. I don't feel like a champion. I don't feel like I'm ready for warfare. But in reality, you are. That God has prepared us for such a time as this. This is why you're on the face of the earth today and not 100 years ago or 200 years ago. You and I are here today. God has given us breath. God has given us life. And God has given us inheritance. God hasn't given up on us. God hasn't given up on his promises. And on the 31st there, you know, I spoke about inheritance. I spoke about these promises of God because I believe another trick of the enemy that he does is he takes our eyes off of the inheritance. He takes our eyes off of the prize and he distracts us with the things that are happening in the moment so that we will lose the big picture of what is going on. I always wonder, and I try to broadcast this if anybody listens. With all the focus on COVID, you ever notice that nothing ever happens anymore other than COVID? I always wonder, what's happening over here while you're focusing people on COVID? What laws are being passed? What decisions are being made? That I believe when COVID blows away, and it will blow away, all of a sudden we're going to wake up and we're going to go, well, when did that happen? When did that news take place? When did Russia all of a sudden invade Ukraine and all this trouble with China and Taiwan? And when did all this happen while we were being distracted over here? And I believe that is a major ploy of the enemy is in warfare, is to create a diversion, is to create a distraction so that we are not focused on the right place. And this morning, I really want to bring a word to us that I've called the survival kit for 2022 so that our focus will come back to the right place. That a lot of things in our lives that are nothing more than smoke and mirrors of the enemy and distractions from keeping us away from what we ought to really be focusing on. And that's our inheritance. That's the things that we have in God. That's the things that are eternal, that are never going to pass away. Because here's the truth. Even if you live to be 100 years old, my friends, this life is passing away. You will leave this life. You will be gone. You will be finished. You're not going to live. You're not going to live forever. And so somewhere in eternity, because of what Christ has done for us, we will live forever. That is part of our inheritance. And I think we need to take our focus off of just the everyday life, in particular all the negativity that we're constantly hearing and saying, is there nothing more to this? I mean, let's ask the question, is God on vacation? Has he left the scene? Is he not involved? Is he not concerned? Does it not matter to him? Is he not moving any longer? Has he given up? Has God said, oh, well, you know what? This Omicron thing is just more than I can handle. I'm just going to take off and go to the Bahamas. Or does God work despite the things? And is God working sometimes behind the scenes and we don't recognize him because our focus isn't there? Everybody say with me, inheritance. You and I have inheritance from God. The things of God. This is what the story of Caleb and Joshua was all about, that God had brought them to incredible promises. And when they arrived there, 10 of the 12 brought back a negative report that melted the heart of the people. And this man, Caleb and Joshua, they had to wait 45 years in order to inherit what God had told them. But my friends, I'll tell you, they were faithful. My friends, they stayed the course. They didn't give up. Because let me say this, in times of distraction and in times of discouragement, it is easy to give up territory. Spiritual territory, prayer territory, physical territory, mental territory, whatever it is, you know, when we are bombarded, and I hear stories every day, man, just breaks my heart of this issue and that problem and this health issue and so-and-so got hurt and all the rest of it. And I'm saying to myself, what is it that the enemy knows that we don't know? Why is he trying to discourage us so badly? Why is he trying to distract us so badly? What is it? What is it that he's trying to divert our attention away from? Does he know something in the heavens about what God is about to do that he's trying to keep us away from, so he puts us in the wrong place? Because he knows his inheritance. He knows the power of the church. He knows the power of the people. And I've said this, you know, and I see this on social media all the time. The people that rip the church, bash the church, tear down the church. I mean, ridicule the church. And I put this online. I said, hey, maybe you've forgotten who the husband of the church is.
Man, the Lord's not going to take kindly to his wife being battered all the time. Does the church have issues? Absolutely. Does the church have problems? Absolutely. But Christ said, I'm married to the church. This is the plan of God. And according to Ephesians 3:10, I am going to manifest my manifold wisdom through the church, through you. You are the agents. You are the people that are going to make it happen, that God is going to work. You say, me? You. Say, oh, pastor, I'm a disaster. I got issues. I got problems. Guess what? You qualify. Those are exactly the people God wants to use. Come on now. Everybody say survival kit. Let me give you an illustration. When I was in the corporate world, every once in a while, they would take us away, you know, the management, they would take us away and put us in a hotel, retreat area, and somewhere in those times, we would have something called a survival exercise. Team building, team bonding. I don't know if you've ever done this before, but here's basically what it was. So they would break up the management into teams, and then they would give you a case scenario. And the case scenario was basically this. You were in a plane. The plane has crashed. You've all lived. And now you would need to make a decision as a team whether you're going to leave the crash site or wait to be rescued. So number one, as a team, you have to decide, do we go or do we stay? What is our best survival opportunity? Do we wait for somebody to rescue us or do we go? If you decide to go, then they say to you, some things have survived from the plane crash, you know, like flashlights, matches, hammer, whatever. You can't take everything, but the things you decide to take as a team, in other words, you have to agree as a team, here are the things we're gonna take. They will determine your long-term survival. And then they had experts there, you know, usually on video. Sometimes they were there in person. And they would give a number. They would give a grade. So, you know, the matches were worth this. The flashlight was worth this. And based on the things that you agreed to take, they gave you points. And then the people that took the right thing had the best chance of survival. And so that's how that team won, because they had a greater survival kit. I began to think about this, and I thought, you know, spiritually, I really believe that when we look at the life of Caleb had some tools in the survival kit that he took with him that allowed him not only to survive, but to thrive and to ultimately receive his inheritance. Because you know what the Bible says? Of all the children of Israel that now went into the promised land, I'm not talking about wilderness people. I'm talking about these are the people that went into the promised land. Only Caleb and Joshua dispossessed the enemy. Only Caleb and Joshua, these are promised land entering people. The other people subdued their enemies. They made their enemies their servants. But Joshua and Caleb understood, we're not here to take prisoners. We're not here to take servants. We are here to dispossess the land. We are here to dispossess the enemy. And we're here to inherit. And we're going to clean it out just as the Lord says. Caleb, believe it or not, is a type of Jesus. He is the leader of the tribe of Judah. And Jesus comes from the tribe of Judah. And so what God is showing us in this man that was very, very different than everybody else is there are qualities of Christ that we need to inherit, that need to become part of our spirit, part of our repertoire, part of our survival kit, if you will, so that we can thrive in 2022. Now, those of you that are just like, pastor, I just want to make it. I just want to live. I just want to get by. I'm not even talking to you people. I'm talking to people that have some vision. I'm talking to people that have some desire. I'm talking to people that understand, my God, my life is greater than what I'm experiencing right now. And someone said to me, well, you know what? Why don't you stay home? Why don't you stay home and just do the service from home? And sure, I can do that. But you see, because I have been given an inheritance, because I've been given a responsibility, because God has put me on guard at the corner of Finchgate and Queen and Brampton, and God has said, now this is your inheritance, and stand on guard until I tell you, I'm going to fulfill that time. What about you? What inheritance have you been given? Your family, your children, your grandchildren. Maybe it's the gifts, the talents, the abilities that that you have been entrusted with. Maybe it's inventions that are still within your spirit that need to come out. Maybe it's your role within society. Maybe you have a public call. I don't know. Maybe some of you are called to be doctors and leaders and influential people. Where has God given you inheritance, and are you possessing that land, or are you giving up territory? It's easy to give up territory. It's easy in times like this to say, oh my God, you know, everybody's down and this isn't happening and that's not going. And pastor, don't you know attendance is down and finances are down. And every day I have to deal with the negativity of what's not happening and what's not working and who's not cooperating. And yet at the same time, hearing from God to say, possess the land. Because here's the truth. If you and I will not possess it, then God will raise up another generation. God will raise up another people that will fulfill his work. You know, I talk about my grandson a lot. This little guy, you know, he's what they call a COVID baby, right? A lot of babies are COVID babies right now. And so he's a year and a half, and if you give this little guy a year and a half, give him an iPad, give him an iPhone, and he's possessive. This little guy can find Netflix. He did it yesterday on my iPad because he knows there's a show that he likes. He finds of all my apps, he finds the Netflix app, clicks it, and eventually finds the program, the movie he wants to watch. I'm looking at him. I'm like, bro, for real? And he loves to watch videos, particularly of himself. And when he thinks he doesn't like the video he's watching, he just starts swiping. Now, let me ask you the question. I guarantee you that at a year and a half, you and I did not have that kind of ability. Come on, you were playing with rocks. You were playing with dirt. And here are these kids today. The technology and the ability within them is absolutely phenomenal. I say, God, for as much as they talk about restrictions and isolation and all the damage that they're doing to these children, by the way, they are, I wonder what God is doing in their lives. I wonder how God is preparing them. I wonder what God is putting in them as far as abilities, so that when the time comes for them, they will be equipped for something. I mean, why don't we just stop talking always about destruction and curses and evil over this generation and begin to say, God, you have a plan for these children. You're not going to give up their mental health. You're not going to give them up to the enemy. There is something that you're going to put in this generation that maybe my generation wasn't equipped to do. Come on, somebody. We ought to be talking life. We ought to be talking prosperity in the sense of growth and favor over these children. Maybe this generation will be a phenomenal generation because of what they are going through. But for me, at this time, I say this, Lord. I say, I want to take my inheritance. Every breath of life you give me, every moment that you give me, everything I can put in the survival kit, I want to take out, watch this, because it's not just for me, it's also for a generation. What I love about Caleb is Caleb, like David, is a giant killer. But I find with David, you know, we focus more on, you know, David killed Goliath. David is this amazing hero, and he is. But what I would love about Caleb is that Caleb wasn't just a giant killer for himself. Caleb was a giant killer because he recognized he was taking other people with him. That Caleb was saying, when I go, you're going to come with me, and we're going to possess it together. we're going to enjoy it together, and we're going to live in it together. And today, you know, I talked about the nation earlier. I just sometimes feel like we've given up. Like you know, we just said, well, that law got passed, and that law got passed, and this government's so antichrist, and we're just so ready to give it up. And we seem to forget that the Lord said, hey, the nations are mine. Isn't this what Daniel said? Daniel says he puts one up, he takes one down. God's not intimidated by what's happening in the world, what, you know, the laws that are being passed. God says at the end of the day, you know, and Kimberly, I don't know if she did it in the second service, but it was, we were worshiping God. You know, she quoted out of the Old Testament and she said, we worship the God that sits on the circle of the earth. And we forget how great big God is sometimes. That God says, you're my footstools. that if it wasn't for his goodness, you know what the Lord would say? He would say, you're like ants to me. You know, Thanos there snaps his little finger. Let me tell you, Thanos is nothing to God. You get the little wrist going on. Pastor Moses would be so impressed with me that I got that right. God is greater. God is amazing. God is awesome. We forget how powerful God is. This is why we worship him. We magnify him. We have the ability, Kimberly, to shift atmospheres. You have that kind of authority. So as we look to this morning, it's almost afternoon, but can I read a few scriptures speaking of, everybody say inheritance. Let's look at Ephesians 1:11. I'm going to come to Caleb in a moment. Ephesians 1:11, Paul says this, in him, in Christ, we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined. In other words, even before you were born, God says, I took care of this. According to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will. Why do we pray thy kingdom come? Because God says, I'm going to work all things according to the counsel of my will. Because my will for you is good. My will for you is good. Ephesians 1 and then verse 12 says this, so that we who were the first to hope in Christ might be to the praise of his glory. My friends, listen. Those that are the ambassadors of hope will own the future. God's people, you and I, we ought to be the distributors of hope. What are people looking for right now? They're looking for hope. Hope that there will be a better day. Hope that this thing will be gone. Hope that, quote unquote, we're going to be getting back to normal. But you see, unlike the world that, you know, they have these phrases, right? We're in this together until we're not. And when their hope is found to be false, they get mean and nasty and divisive. But the hope of God that ignites faith isn't like that. You and I, my friends, are the distributors of hope. Doesn't even end there. In verse 18, he says this, same chapter, having the eyes of your hearts enlightened, that you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, and what are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints. God says, my things are glorious. They are rich. They're amazing. They're awesome. I have incredible things for you. You want to live, my friends, a life that is full, a life that is fascinating, a life that is exciting. Live for God. Nothing will fill you more. Nothing will thrill you more. Nothing will excite you more than living for God. Then in Colossians 3 and 24, he says, knowing that from the Lord, who? From the Lord, you will receive the inheritance as your reward. How many people could use some rewards? Come on. Are you alive today? If Pastor Moses was here, he'd be tearing a strip out of you right now. Your reward. The inheritance of the Lord that he has predestined for you already. And then he says this, you are serving the Lord Christ. You are, so why do we come on a Sunday? Why do we risk? We come out, Why do we risk? Because we need to worship God. Because at the end of the day, we recognize that our worship of God is even important than the life that we live. You've been put on this earth to make a difference, to show the way, to be a worshiper of God, to show forth the glory and how amazing our God is. I had a lady in the first service. Her husband is in the hospital right now in intensive care. You would think, I prayed for her this morning, you would think that woman came in here groveling and whimpering. My God, I mean, I think she was encouraging me. She's talking about God and faith and ability and healings and telling God we need this miracle, that miracle, these things need to happen. I was like, I mean, that woman understands warfare. That woman understands when Isaiah says, who has believed our report? And it's not that, watch this, it's not that faith denies the facts. Faith does not deny the facts. Faith knows the truth. The truth is Christ. The truth is that the Lord is able. My friends, God is able. And this Caleb is exactly what he said in that day. He said, God is able to give it to us now. Let's get on with it. Let's get going on this thing. Let's make it happen. Yes, fortified cities. Yes, there's giants. Yes, there's some strong people there that need to be rooted out, but we are well able. He said, let's get on. But he had to wait. What I love about this guy is 45 years later, he's 85, 45 years later in this survival kit that he has, he has not lost his passion. He has not lost his determination. He has not lost his faith. He has not lost his focus on God. He has somehow maintained, and we heard it from Candace, right? He has somehow kept his nature on God, that God is still good even when bad things are happening. See, we are told to believe that when bad things happen, God is bad. God is never bad. God is always good. God is saying, my nature never changes. Let me help us. That we blame God for things God has never done. I get these messages, you know, God's punishing me, God's hurting me, God. And when you really begin to boil it, you know what you recognize? People are eating at the trough of the decisions they made, but then they blame God. See, you want to do things according to the counsel of your will and then just want God to bless you. But God says, no, I've got to work out my will in your life and then I can bless you. So instead of blaming God, why don't you repent? Say, Lord, I was stubborn. I was rebellious. I made my own decisions. I find myself here today. I don't want to be here. I repent. Get me back on track. That's a better prayer. Say to God, work out my life according to the counsel of your will and work out my life according to the inheritance that you've given me. I want to go into the survival kit. Three things I want to tell you very quickly. But I want to draw your attention. I don't know if you've been following the story of these missionaries. One of them was a Canadian, actually, that were kidnapped in Haiti. Did you hear about this story? I think there was 17 of them, if I got my facts right. And even a 10-month-year-old baby was amongst them. I began to read the report. They were captured, they were held, and they began to pray, and they said, you know, we were praying about 3 hours a day. And then they said something happened. All of a sudden, we moved from 3 hours a day to 24/7 prayer. There was always somebody or multiple people awake, and we just began to pray round the clock, round the clock, round the clock, round the clock, all the time, 24/7. And they said, you know, it was like there was a grace there. It was like there was an anointing. I want to talk to you about that right now. That there was something that was happening even in our prayer that was not just natural, it was supernatural. But this is the part that got me. They said, you know, remember I told you about survival at the beginning? They said there was one thing we could not agree on. He said, the thing we could not get everybody to agree on was, should we stay here and wait to be rescued or someone is going to pay the ransom, or do we escape? Now, they're in Haiti. They're in ganglands. They're somewhere deep in the wilderness. They got a 10-month-old baby with them, and there's talk of, we need to escape. We need to survive. We need to somehow get through the jungle. God only knows what's in the jungle. And so people would not agree. Some people were like, yes, no, yes, no. And until they had agreement, they didn't go. But then in the interview, the one individual said, there came a moment we all agreed. There came a moment we all agreed we're going to escape. And in the middle of the night, baby and all, they all agree. Watch this now. You know, to me, prayer is like the Air Force. It gives you like air cover. But watch what happened in the power of unity. When they all agreed, having prayed and provided all that air force, they all take off in the middle of the night. They get through the fencing. They get past the guards into the jungle. They finally find someone that you know, had a phone. They get to the authorities, and all of them are back home now, including the baby. Not one life was lost. But watch what they did. Nobody made a move until they agreed. Nobody said, okay, you 10 people stay back here. No, no, no. They said, we all go, including the baby. My friends, listen, there is power in continual prayer, and there is power in unity. The Bible says, that's where I'm going to command the blessing. And this is what I believe. Listen to me. I believe this is the greatest curse of COVID. I have never seen something so divisive as COVID. Like godly people, praying people. I was on some thread yesterday, and I was like, Lord, these are godly spiritual people, but their opinions are so diverse. See, this is a natural virus, but it's a spiritual virus. It's a wicked thing because it is dividing even the body of Christ. And the enemy knows, if I could just keep these people divided, if I could keep them distracted, if I could keep them fighting, if I jab, no jab, job, no job, if I could just keep them all intermingled into this thing and they don't really get focused on what they ought to be doing, I'll keep them in this state. Everybody say survival kit. In Numbers, I'm almost done, in Numbers 14:23, what God says about Caleb, God says, you have a different spirit, Caleb. You see, church, listen, it's one thing for you to tell God what you think about yourself. It's one thing for you to think something about yourself. It's one thing for you to tell even other people, well, this is what I think I'm doing for God, and this is what I think I am. But when God backs you up, when God says, I've looked at you, I've heard you, I've assessed you, I've done a survey of everybody around you, and Caleb, you have another spirit. Caleb, there's something different about you. There was something unique about you that other than Joshua, I didn't find it in anybody. When God says that about you, you want to pray a dangerous prayer? Ask God what he thinks about you. We had somebody come into the office. Candace was there, and the person said, you know, I don't want to wait till I'm dead and people say good things about me. I want you to write my eulogy right now. Candace responded and said, stop your foolishness. We're not going to do that. See, it's one thing for people to say nice things about you and good things about you, but what about God? What do you love God to say about you? Hey, Noelle, is that you, Noelle? I think it's you. Hey, Noelle, there's something different about you. There's something that's not like everybody else. You're not the average. You're not the status quo. You don't just fit in. There is something about you that stands out. I mean, when you impress God, you've done something. And church, as I'm talking about the survival kit, please hear my heart. I am not talking about, well, let's, you know, grin our teeth and bear it and mind over matter and you know, let's get it in the human will. And No. And there's truth to that stuff, but hear me right now. I'm talking about what God puts in our spirit. I'm talking about something on the inner man that's beyond the will, beyond the emotion, even beyond the strength of mind. There's something that God puts in your spirit that makes you different than everybody else. People go, I don't get you. I don't understand you. You know, you're going through these things, and why are you so determined? And why are you so, you know, and why are you so focused on it? It's even as you know, they got irritated at Jesus because the Bible says his face was towards Jerusalem all the time. He was like, that's where I'm going. That's where I'm headed. That's where I'm going to be. That's my accomplishment. That's my destiny. That's my inheritance. And the Bible says they were irritated because he's always focused there. But you see, it was in his spirit. My friends, when I'm talking about surviving, I'm not talking about you're going to generate this. I'm talking about that, can I say it this way? That we're in the presence of God so that God infects us. I'm tired of all these infections. I want to be infected by God. I want to begin to spread some things that I got from God. I want to get a contagion that I got in the presence of God. You know, we hear, don't let anybody breathe on you. Well, then let God breathe on us. So he says there's another spirit about you. You're unique, man. And so first thing I want to say is what do we need in our toolkit here, our survival kit? First thing I said is be valiant. What do I mean? Possessing unprecedented determination. I think the three Hebrew children had this in their survival kit when they said to Nebuchadnezzar, listen, Nebuchadnezzar, our God is able to deliver us. You want to put us in that fire? You want to cook us like chicken? Let me tell you something. Even if God does not, we will not bow down. That they were saying there is an unprecedented determination, almost like a holy defiance that says we're not giving up, we're not giving in, we're not bowing down, we're not going to give ground, we're not going to give up our standards, we're not going to be giving up our values, we're going to be valiant. We're going to make it all the way. That's why Jesus said, the person that endures to the end, we're going to be fearless. We're going to be bold because we understand God, you're with us. My friends, if we're going to survive 2022 and beyond, we're going to have to need to be valiant. That somewhere I've drawn the line, that somewhere I say, I will not give up. I will not compromise because not only for me, there's a generation that is waiting for me. I wonder if this generation will look at us someday and say, what did you people do during COVID? You spent billions of dollars and accomplished nothing. You allowed governments to trample all kinds of freedoms and break all kinds of laws. How did you allow yourself to be captured by so much rhetoric and so much fear? And how did you give up so much ground that maybe you'll never get back? How did you allow all those churches to shut down? What did you do? See, we want to be remembered that we were valiant, that we were in the fight, that we were in the battle, and maybe a next generation will look at us and say, wow, you were nothing but scaredy cats. See, church, let me ask the question, and I'm online. Are we going to allow God to raise up another generation? Are we going to allow God to say, hey, when you're all dead in the wilderness, I will raise up another generation because somebody will inherit? Are we going to allow someone else to do it? Everybody say, be valiant. Number two, look at this, an accurate assessment of our God-given abilities and strength. Listen to what Caleb says. He says, as yet I am as strong this day as on the day that Moses sent me in. Just as my strength was then, so my strength is now for war, both for going out and for coming in. It's almost like Caleb is saying, the more I fight, the stronger I get. I go out to war, I come back invigorated. 45 years, I've not lost my passion. I've not lost my zeal for life. I've not lost my zeal for God. I've not lost my inheritance. I've not lost what God has for me. He's saying I'm as strong today as I was then. What about you? Spiritually. Are you spiritually as strong? Do you have that vitality? Do you have that fire? And here again, you got to hear my heart. I'm not even saying that you created. What I'm saying is we come into the presence of God to say, God, if you're not going to put it in us, if we don't receive it from us, because my friends, I'm telling you that people that are touched by God, they become radical people. They're just different. They're wild. That's why his name means mad dog. This is a ravaging dog that is stuck on a bone, and he's like, I will not be denied. I will not give up. I will not give in. You're going to give me. This is why he said to Joshua, you know what Moses said. Give me this mountain. This is my bone. You're not keeping from me, Joshua. You know, Daniel says that they that know their God shall be strong and do great exploits. My friends, listen to me. Fight discouragement. Fight discouragement with everything you have within you. Every arsenal, every ounce of energy, because that is the thing that will suck the life right out of you. The enemy wants to discourage us and then bring us into fear, because fear paralyzes. But you see, when we get the joy of the Lord, then we get the strength of the Lord. You say, Pastor, can people be joyful in the midst of what's going on? Absolutely. Absolutely. I've told you about my mom, and you know, the holidays are tough. The holidays are hard when, for the first time, you know, you have all these memories and all these things go on. And watch this. You can get into that thing that literally a spirit of despair will cripple you. It's healthy to grieve, but grieving at some point has to end. And suddenly you turn those moments into joy. You turn those memories, and there are certain things that remind me of my mom and my dad. And rather than grieving at that moment, I turn them into joy. My family will say, oh, Dad, you know, that's what Nonu would do, or that's what Nona would do, and we laugh and we rejoice. Why am I saying that? That my friends, when we have Christ, even in the midst of grief, there comes joy. Joy that we're going to see them. Joy that we're going to be with them again. Joy for the legacy that they have left us, and that we have a responsibility to live out that legacy. Come on, my friends. How many grandmothers do you have, and grandfathers and parents and people that prayed for you that you would get everything in God? Are you living up to that? I heard a song. I sent it to some of the worship team, and I sent it to Kimberly. Kimberly, you got my song, right? You got my video? That's right, sister. There's a reason for that. And the song was called Talking to Jesus. Go look it up. Is it Maverick City that talking to? Oh, I found this song. And I just filled up with tears, man, because about everyday life. The song starts out basically by the man, you know, the guy's singing it, Brandon Lake, I think is his name, and he says, you know, I used to hear my grandma pray by her bed, and you know, she'd pray in tongues, and I thought she was out of her mind. That's literally in the song. And she said, I'm not out of my mind. I'm talking to Jesus. and then there's this kind of this generational transfer of what happens. And all of a sudden, it kind of ends with probably the person beginning and saying, and now my son, my 15-year-old son, is now talking to Jesus. My friends, listen, you can talk to a lot of people, but nothing will be the same as when you talk to Jesus. And somewhere, see, it's good to pray for people, but somewhere you gotta teach people to talk to Jesus for themselves. This generation. Last one, an undivided heart that is determined on wholly following the Lord no matter what comes. My friends, I really believe, I want to nail two things and I'm done. Number one, I have such a grave concern of what I see as a mixture. There's a mixture in our modern day Christianity of I can have God and I can have other things too. And I was saying this recently to to somebody online. I said, you know, we are so insecure as God's people. See, that we need famous people to get saved, and then famous people will tell everybody they follow Jesus, that somehow that brings validity to the fact that we are born again people. You know what? You don't need famous people to follow Jesus for you to feel good about your faith. You ought to feel good about your faith because you know Jesus. And we have famous people when we're so insecure that immediately we put them on pedestals and platforms and make them preachers and teachers. And most of the times they get it wrong. They lead people astray because they've not been disciplined in the Word of God. They haven't been taught. They haven't been fathered. They haven't been coached. But because they're famous, we think they should have a voice. I would remind us that the Apostle Paul, when he met Jesus, I mean Jesus, Jesus knocked him off his high horse. The Bible says for 13 years, nobody heard about Paul. Growing with the Lord, studying, praying, 13 years. Today he'd have his own podcast, YouTube channel, Facebook page, Instagram, TikTok. On the very first day, we would put Paul everywhere. Because we're living in a day where we need famous people to talk about the Lord. My friends, listen, God doesn't need anybody to talk about him that's famous. God says, I just need simple, everyday people. I just need ordinary people that are undivided, that are focused, that are sold out. All I need is people that will submit their heart to me. I don't need famous people. You say, Pastor, you don't want famous people to come? Of course I do. But they got to come like everybody else. They have to be tall like everybody else. They have to be disciplined like everybody else. Your fame, I'm not talking about evangelism. I'm not talking about that. But I'm talking about people now that have a voice. Let me give an example. So I don't want to say the name. I'm online and then I get all this hatred and famous Canadian superstar singer who is doing some worship sets with famous people. I might even be Mavericks. I'm not even sure. Let me get my names right. But famous sets. And then other people posted, oh, so-and-so is singing with so-and-so and they're doing worship. Now, because I follow music, then I go into their secular stuff. And I go, hold on. Yesterday, Jesus was king. Today, the devil's king. Who are we worshiping here? But you see, because we're so insecure and we don't do our homework and we're so gullible, we just go, oh, so-and-so came to Jesus. My friends, I'm not sure if they came to Jesus. I hope they came to Jesus. And I hope that their journey is complete. But let's have some discernment to go up to the tree and to be able to say, oh yeah, this is an apple tree because apples are actually growing on it. Oh, you're so judgmental. You think you're so, no. You know, if I hear this again, you know, oh, you shouldn't judge. Let me tell you something. If you are not judging things, you are being fooled. The idea of when Jesus said, do not judge, what he's saying there is don't condemn people unto their final place of you know, a law being passed against them or a court ruling being passed against them. But every day, my friends, you and I ought to be judging. Is this God? Is this not God? Is this right? Is it not right? Is this the mind of the Lord? Is it not the mind of the Lord? Not that we are super spiritual or above anybody else, but my friends, we ought to be discerning. Tired of God's people being so gullible, and because they're famous, so they sing a worship song. What is the fruit of their life? Jesus said, you shall know them by their fruit, not by their talent, not by their ability, not by their anointing, by their fruit. Is there any fruit on the tree? And watch this. Here, I'll close my Bible. Which is funny because I was talking out of my iPad. But anyway,
When Jesus wanted figs, I love figs. Do figs grow in Trinidad? Yeah. I never had figs in Trinidad. Next time. All right. Jesus wanted figs, and he saw a fig tree, and he went there, and there were no figs. And Jesus didn't bless the tree. Jesus didn't say, listen, little fig tree, you're gonna produce 1,000 figs. No, he said, I'm going to curse you. You'll never live again. Whoever you are out there, I hear that voice. Thank you. I sense the encouragement. I bless you. He cursed the tree and said, you'll never have fruit again. You see, I don't want to be like that. That when the master comes and he says, I need some figs, that we would have said, master. Final thought. Worship team, come up. I want to sing, this time I want to sing Angus Day, is that what we call it? Yeah. Kimberly, you're gonna find out. I kind of make up my own songs, my own titles. You'll get used to me. But come on, let's stand, church. Here's last thing. Everybody say last thing. We need to calibrate our heart and our mouth. Survival kit. What are you saying, Pastor? Out of the abundance of the heart. Can I come to this camera? Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. The majority of what is in your heart is going to come out of your mouth. And in this season, we need to, you know, not only collaborate, but make sure there is an absolute plumb line between our heart and our mouth, so that when our mouth speaks, it's declaring the things that we have put in there from God that are in our heart. You know what Caleb said? He said, when I brought back the report, he said, I brought back everything that was in my heart, which was what? Faith, ability, we can do this. What did the other spies do? The Bible says they melted the heart of the people. We will have no melting hearts here. Prophesy over your own heart every day and say, heart, you will not melt. You will not melt today. You will not, you know, you won't melt in front of sickness. You won't melt in front of disease. You're not going to melt in front of intimidation. You're not going to melt in front of the enemy. You're going to have a different perspective to you, because you are going to advance. I show up here, I just tell you what's in my heart. And hopefully, and I say this humbly, that I have heard what is on the heart of God. Because I would have gone a different, honestly, I felt to go a different direction, but I felt the Lord say, no, this is what's on my heart. Son, stay here. I love you know, how Kimberly worships. So she goes, you know, I feel like we need to stay here. Huh? We you know, Kimberly, we got to learn to sing the songs that make the Holy Ghost happy. And maybe we need to sing some lyrics over and over again until they get into our spirit. Huh? Not just our mind, but into our spirit, so that when we walk out of, I don't know, maybe we walk out of here with one line, one thought, one lyric that, you know, that they say, you know, that's the thing that got into my spirit. I get, Kimberly, they make fun of me at the house all the time, because I'll sing one, even in the staff, you know, one song, one line. And they're like, don't you know any other line? I'm like, that's the most important line in the song. Come on, somebody. It's the most important line in the song. Sing the song that makes the Holy Ghost happy. Sing the word that makes the Holy Ghost happy. Sing it. Sing it until you get happy. Come on, Kimberly. Hallelujah. Let's raise it up. Let's raise it up to God. Come on now. Worship with me. Come on. Lift up your voice. Lift up your hands to the Lord. He's here. The Spirit of God is here. Every voice. Tell him, prophesy.
Hallelujah.
Tell the principalities and powers.
Hallelujah. For the Lord God Almighty
sing it again. Hallelujah. Let's sing it to the master.
Hallelujah.
Church, I want to pray for you. Every Sunday in January, I've been doing this for years. There's four things I want to pray for you in 2022. And if those of you that are online and can't join us, obviously, the last two Sundays, either by phone, by Zoom, I'm going to pray for you. But if you want prayer, here's what we're going to do. I'm going to pray this over you. And then I'm going to put on my mask. I'm going to stand right here. If you and your family would like prayer, I'm going to lay hands on you. So we have the point of contact, but here's the four things that I want to pray as the worship team continues. Number one, Psalm 125 and 2 says this, as the mountains surround Jerusalem, so the Lord surrounds his people for from this time forth and forever. Number one, that God would surround you. Number two, that you would live your life according to script. This is the will of God. This is the counsel of his will. This is what Jesus did. Number three, what we talked about this morning, that you would possess another spirit, that you would possess this anointing of Caleb. And that number four, as John three, as John said in the third book, verse 1 and 2, beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in health. That you may prosper in all things and be in health, even as your soul prospers. I want to thank those that are joining us online. Bless you, appreciate you. Those of you that are in the room, I want you to lift up your hands right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, I declare the blessing of Almighty God. I declare that as the mountains surround Jerusalem, so you will surround your people. Lord, I pray that you're the people of God in 2022. Will draw from the survival kit, will live their life according to script. Understand that the counsel of your will is right and good and is for them. Father, I pray that their hearts would be undivided. I pray that they would be valiant. I pray that this other spirit, this different spirit, this unique spirit that was in Caleb will also be in them, that you will give them valor
and longevity and strength for war. And then, Father, I pray that they may prosper and be in health, even as their soul prospers. I declare that anointing upon each and every one and every family. God, you are able in the midst of pandemics, in the midst of recessions and everything else, you are able to prosper us in the mighty name of Jesus.
Wow, what an incredible word. Don't forget to follow us on our social media platforms and subscribe to us on our YouTube page so you know what's happening right here at APC. Stay safe and have an amazing week.